Okay, I was going to start off by asking, what do you know about the legends of Odudawa and Lamrudu in West Africa? Because I know you know a lot about African culture, West Africa.
Yes, yes. I'm not sure about the two names, so I haven't evidently come across them yet.
Okay.
Odudawa, and who was, what was the other one?
Well, let's just say, do you know any, did you ever hear anything in Africa about Nimrod and Dedan and Kush in West Africa?
Not where I was. You know, where I was mainly the Wolof, Serier, Bambara, Fulani, and Jola.
Okay.
I wanted to show you the Jola dance as well, since you asked me that, because that was similar to what you had, we had spoke about before in East Africa.
Oh, okay.
But those were the people mainly who we were around. And we did see some Tuareg and, you know, a few other people.
And was that in Senegal or?
Yeah, that was in Dakar.
Oh, Dakar.
And then, mainly in Dakar and, you know, the surrounding towns around Dakar.
Right, right.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I mean, it's not that you would necessarily hear about it, but the only reason I ask is because one of the major traditions in West Africa in terms of origins has to do with being from Canaan, as you know, because I've been talking about it for this last few years, Canaan. Mm-hmm. However, a lot of people don't know that as well, many of the traditional African so-called deities.
Say that again.
The traditional so-called deities.
Oh, okay.
Ancestral deities of West Africans, namely Yoruba, Hausa, the areas of Benin and the Nuk and Masi, and many of those tribes have similar traditions about coming from Canaan, and they are often intermingled with the tradition about Dedan and Nimrod, who you will hear under the pronunciation as Odudawa or Odudua,
mm-hmm.
and Lamrudu. So that's what I was gonna talk about today, and talk about how the traditions came to, you know, be
okay, prominent. Can I ask you something before you get started, please?
Yes.
Now, I noticed you said, now I'm looking at the word Odu, because
go ahead.
And what reason, because I've heard that word, and it was dealing with Odu-Ifa.
Uh-huh.
So I know a little, very little about the people in those areas. So,
right. And okay. Usually when we think about Ifa religion and that kind of thing, we think of non-traditional, non-Muslim, non-yes. Christian, non-Judaic religion, yes. Right? And we think of them as the traditional religion of those people.
Mm-hmm.
But it so happens that a lot of that so-called traditional religion is in itself related to early traditions of the Torah. And they were actually brought in by the people I call the Nagai or Sugai or ancestors of the Songhai. In the north, the people are called Zagawa. In other places, they were called Azuag or Zawaga or Zalge or Sugai. Okay, but the name Songhai is connected. And those people were originally the main bringers of, they were the populations that we call Bari Bari or Barbara. That's an indigenous name of the Zagai people. Otherwise in Libya called Zagawa, in Sudan called Zagawa or Zawge or Zawaga. So the fact that those names have been kind of Arabized and Latinized, or we knew them by the more Arabized form of Zawaga or Zagawa. But as I had said, that the name of the, in traditional Berber genealogy, the name Zagai or Zagai is connected to, in the Maghreb, you might hear it, the name as Zakia. And this name is also a biblical name, and you find it as Zakai. In fact, you find it as one of the Judean tribes, Zakai, connected to the, was it Heber? But anyway, it's in the Torah. And means the pure meat. Now, supposedly the word Zagawa is the Arab term for one of the types of sheep that the Zagawa use. So it's the name of a sheep, and it's also the name of the people. But from what I understand, the indigenous name of the Zagawa is Beri Beri. And that's why you find the Kanuri next door also calling themselves Beri Beri. And I've also emphasized that according to many traditions, the early Zagai people, Sugai or Songhai peoples, also known as Jerma Songhai, because they originally occupied areas like Jerma and Sudan, along with the Tuareg, and even further westwards in Zugatania area of Carthage. I had said that these people were often considered by the Arabic writers to be Jews. Not only by the Arabic writers, but by later Songhai related peoples or author of Tariq al-Sudan and Tariq al-Fatash, okay, claim that the Songhai and related Songing peoples were descendants of Aaron and Jethro. And they were somehow, I think, because of a conflict with their king, they were expelled from the area, whatever area they're talking about. Okay. So I'm going to show you how this kind of fits in with the narrative or traditional narrative of being descendants of Odudawa. And one of the things I was saying on Facebook today is the reason that it's so important to understand the connection between Arabia and the early Africans, or the African roots of the earliest Arabians, is because the Africans had a certain way of looking at the nature and the cosmos and the ancestors. So ancestors often became divinized or divine. And when you're talking about somebody like Odudawa or Lamrudu, Namrudu, you're talking about divine ancestors. You're not just talking about, you know, some archetypal deity. So that is why when you look at many of the deities of the so-called pagan or traditional Africa, those deities actually correspond in large part to the ancient so-called prophets of the Torah, or the people, and many of the people of Genesis. So, because I have seen on my old, one of my old haunts, which is Egypt Search, people talking about, Dana likes to relate everything to, and this is an old post, I guess, Dana likes to relate everything to Arabia, and likes to exoticize Africans in that way. And I think people are not getting what I'm trying to say. And that is that Arabia was at that time affiliated with Africans. Africa was part of what's called Arabia. Arabia was basically occupied by the same people we now know as sub-Saharan Africans. And that's from east to west. People related to Africans south of the Sahara or Sahel, and well, people in the Sahel extending from Abyssinia to West Africa, Mauritania, Senegal, Cairo. Not only that, they settled further south and developed, probably helped to develop civilizations like Zimbabwe. And you know, that's where you also get these, the connection, the Bantu connections with the Lemba or the Jews that came southward from Sena in the Hadhramout. Okay? But this had to have been thousands of years ago, not necessarily, you know, we're not talking about even a few hundred years BC. We're talking about maybe beginning, you know, in the latter part of the second millennium BC. We're talking about a time when Arabia was occupied by basically the same people that are now occupying a large parts of the Western Sudan, meaning western part of Africa, and that used to occupy the Maghreb, because a lot of these people have since been moving southward into, you know, further south into Africa, in around, they ended up around Guinea and the Gold Coast in Guinea and even Central Africa. Now, we don't have to go over that again, is because, again, I don't want people saying that, you know, thinking that I'm talking about something recent. When I say Arab, I don't usually say, even use the term Arab. I'm talking about Arabian or the early and ancient Arabian. Okay. The people that, well, the earliest medieval writers spoke about as being Black, because as I went over in on the Facebook recently, there are many early writings after Islam that say that most Arabs are near Black with kinky hair, or woolly hair, actually. And even in colonial times, when you have, you know, the untouched part of the Arabian desert between even northern, between Basra and Damascus, Basura, as it was called, and Damascus, you have colonialists saying the people of the inner parts of the desert are near Black with, you know, woolly type hair. I also mentioned that they could run fast. So that settles it, right? That part. But anyway, we know from looking at the Gaur, or Gore, Jordan Valley area, that there are still these people, you know, basically woolly-haired people, Bedouin people as well. You know, we see them in the colonial, the photography of the colonialists, the late colonialists of the early 20th century. They show the Gaur or Gaurana people of the Jordan Valley, who are near Black with, often with kinky or woolly hair. So all what I'm saying there is that, you know, from the, what when the colonialists said that the people were near Black with woolly hair, they were talking about these people, okay, who are still there near Black with woolly hair. So when I put them on Facebook, I put them in my blog spot, that the people of the Gaur Valley often kind of interpreted as the Valley of Blacks, or Black, the Valley Blacks, and who people are today trying to say are descendants mainly of slaves, of African slaves. So, okay, so that most of that part is over. So I wanted to go to what was put on my blogspot several years ago with regards to Odudawa and the legends of Nimrod. Because Odudawa is the son of Nimrod, and they're both giants, according to legend. Let's see if we put this, share this if possible. So I have on my website, I wrote about the legend of Odudawa, who was the Joseph speaks of him as Yudadas, who went westward to become Western Ethiopians. And he has them as descendants of Keturah, the people that settled in first in the Troglodyte area of the Horn, where now peoples like the Somali and others are located, the Afar, Danakil, and other peoples. So he said that they, and as well as other descendants of Keturah, the Midianites, Afar, the Sarim or Assurim, and other groups which can be identified as modern Cushitic peoples, as well as some Tuareg peoples, Ephren or Afrin, traveled westward with Hercules. Okay, and this Hercules, it happens to be Melkarth of the Carthaginians or Phoenicians. Because as I've mentioned previously, I mean, they try to say, it's the Phoenicians that, or Canaanites that they try to exoticize and make into non-African people. However, the people called Phoenicians were considered the same people as the Nabataeans and were considered to have come from the Eritrean Sea, not from, from further north, not from from Macedonia, like they try to make the Philistines into Macedonians today, but from the Eritrean Sea, along with or according to our tradition, of course, of Elphilas and the Sida, or Sidonians, also came from this, both came from the same people in this, in the Eritrean area. So Lamrudu, according to certain writers, was associated with the foundation of certain kingdoms, such as Togo, Naomi, Benin, and Oyo. We're talking about Odudawa and Nimrod. And his sons were said to have become rulers in Kanem Bornu and in the Hausa state of Gobir, the Gobirawa. And all of these areas are associated with, again, the people that are called Zakai or Zagai or Sugai in West Africa. They were otherwise called Barbara or Barbara. And, under earlier, they're called Wangara or Wakur in the Tariq al-Fatat and other manuscripts. So the Wangara or Wangarawa merchants are also the same people that were called Gara or Garama further north and founders of Garamantia. Okay, another people, which according to St. Isidore of Seville were black-skinned people or Ethiopian people. And earlier writers said were black-skinned people. Yet colonials have made into, early colonials had made into white machofocal people, white Berber people, instead of the black Berber people that they are. So as I said, the word El Barabir, and this is the problem with, talking about early Berbers in the sense of modern Berbers, because today we think of Berbers as just mainly, mixed or near white people in North Africa. When in fact, earlier writers, Arabic writers, refer to black peoples as Bari Bari, El Barabir. Okay, the ancestors of the Genawa and the Soninck, the Songhai, the Kanuri are all Berber according to different writings. And the Zagawa and Zawaga especially, who of course have been, they've changed into white Berbers or trying to change into white Berbers. They're so dis kind of so separated in their thinking from modern Africans that they don't recognize when they're talking about the Berber Zawaga that, you know, those people were identified as the Berber Zagawa and also Azawag or Azawaga, who are among the first black slaves brought to Portugal. Okay, so the thing about Odudawa, like I say, is that it's very much intermingled in the traditional religions of many West African peoples, the same peoples that are now saying and have, you know, been called in the past Jews. Or, you know, today, for example, there's a nationalist, kind of nationalist tendency for Yoruba and other groups to remember their Jewish heritage. Let's put it that way. And then the Akan used to say that they were also descendants of Babylonians and that kind of thing. The Asantahin or Akan people. But anyway, and I'm just trying to show where these beliefs or traditions come from, because they are based in certain facts. And that is the movement of certain Yemenite or South Arabian peoples originally from before 1000 BC back into Africa, and their movement across the Sahara and the Maghreb, and, you know, the early foundations of Carthage and other sites in Libya are connected to this movement. At least according to, it would seem that archaeology seems to corroborate some of this by the finding of Phoenician relics underneath the Garamantian tombs. And of course, unfortunately, a lot of Western academics or scholars don't think of Africans as being Semitic peoples, so they don't understand the connection of these Garamantian peoples and Zagai peoples with the Canaanites or Phoenicians. They tried to exoticize them into, you know, something from an MGM picture. This, the so-called Semitic peoples of the MGM picture or Hollywood. But what I wanted to bring up was that all the characters mentioned in the traditions are not only connected with the traditional religious folk history of West Africa, but are also found in the Torah and much, much earlier in, they're related to certain kings or rulers in the king list of ancient Mesopotamia. So for example, well, let's just go here. I'm just going to say this for now. Okay, so Dedan, as most scholars would admit, is Yudadas or Yudadas of the Bible or Torah. Dedan and Yudadas are one name, really. And Josephus just reminds us that it was believed at the time that those people were also black. Okay, were peoples of Western Ethiopia, meaning West Africa, because at that time there was no Africa per se. There were only peoples like the Afar or Afarik that went westward into Tunisia and named the area Ifriqiya. Okay, from their ancestor Farik, son of, often called Ifriqush Tuba, the Himyarite ruler or Sabian ruler, otherwise called Farik, son of Ham. Okay, so Dedan or Yudadas is Odudawa. However, he's son of Nimrod, who is called son of Kush in the Bible, called son of Canaan by certain medieval writers like Al-Masudi, calls him son of Canaan, as well as the son of Mesh, son of Aram. So for example, remember the Berbers considered themselves sons of Mazik, son of Canaan. Okay. In early Sumerian king list, you have a Meskiag Kesh or Meskiag Kesher, who was son of Utu, but was father of Enmerud or Enmerkar, who was said to be, or thought by certain scholars to be the Nimrod of, you know, the Torah, or mentioned by these medieval Arabic speaking writers. Now, Meskiag Kash, notice Mazik, the names Mazik and Kash, very likely in this name. Remember Odudawa was son of Nimrod, and Nimrod was son of Kush, or son of Mesh. So here we have the name Meskiag Kash, son of Utu, who was the father of Enmerud. It's often written, it's like Emerud or Enmar, sorry, Enmar Kar, meaning Enmar the hunter, supposedly. Okay, so he was a ruler of the Sumerian, or it was written in Sumerian texts in Uruk, which was in southern Mesopotamia. Now let me just go here because, oops, let's see where we are. Okay, this is the site of Uruk or Warka in southern Mesopotamia. And you notice the stone masonry. So of course, you know, this was a highly developed civilization, which of course Orientalist scholars, colonial scholars did not want to connect with Black people, even though Nimrod was supposed to be the leader of the Nabataeans, who are called Black by people like Al-Masudi, and are connected with Kush and Canaan by people like Al-Masudi. So, you know, much of this stuff is just avoided. Let me see. Are you saying this?
You're still on the legend of Odudawa on that page.
Okay, sorry. Here we go.
Okay, I thought you had switched.
So did I. Okay. All right. So this is what I'm talking about.
Oh.
Uruk or Warka in southern Iraq. Okay. So supposedly the first king was according to the early Arabic traditional legends, was Nimrod, who was son of Casit, Namir ibn Casit, otherwise called son of Canaan, because Canaan was actually the son of Cush as well in certain medieval texts, as well as sometimes he's considered the father of Canaan's considered the father of Cush sometimes, and sometimes Cush is considered the father of Canaan. And all of these groups are related to Mash and Aram, as well as, the Nabataeans. Okay, let me just go to, let me get back to my post. I don't know if I should go. Let's see. Try this first. So, you'll find the Nabataeans are, you know, in the early Arabic writings of people like Ibn Sa'd. Am I sharing? No, I'm not sharing.
No.
Okay. Okay, I'm here in the third paragraph, or third portion. The Nabataeans, he said, were the descendants of Nubayt, Ibn Mash, Ibn Aram, Ibn Shem, Ibn Noah. Among the sons of Mash, son of Aram, son of Shem, son of Noah, is Nabayt, from whom are sprung all the Nabataeans and their kings. As I had mentioned before, and this has been pointed out, that the Nabataeans were also called, later called Chaldeans, but that here he's writing that the dialects were adopted by the Assyrians and Chaldeans, and that one of, you know, Ibn Nadim, in the book by Ibn Nadim, who was a Nabataean, I think, he quotes one of the Ibn Nadim quotes the Nabataean magicians who were living during that time, that saying the Nabataeans were people with black complexion. So Ibn Nadim was, I think he was like the 11th century, I can't remember exactly, but remember I had said that al-Damashqi, also writing about the sons of Ham, said that the Nabataeans were among the black sons of Ham. So anyway, this guy, Sa'd Abdul Hab, who wrote this paragraph about Ibn Nadim, is the one who translated the text of the Sumerian text of Gilgamesh, and who claimed that the early Sumerians were actually early Arabs, or that the early Sumerian could be translated because it's an early form of Arabic. So the reason I'm bringing this all up is because, let's go back to you know what? In fact, I need to go to my post about the Dawasir and where the original Namir ibn Casit came from, because the name Namir ibn Casit was not just the name of an ancient ancestor, but of a tribe of early Arabs. And these early Arabs, according to Arabic tradition, came from the same people that were called Rabi'a or Rabi'a. And possibly the people called Rabbeans in Mesopotamia, Rabbeans or Rabbeans. Rabbeans were people who are mentioned in early texts of the Mesopotamia as Amorites. Okay.
Let's see, the Amorites.
Yeah, I don't have that here.
Oh, okay.
Let's see, but let me go back to my post on Facebook I was putting up today, because that's where I was talking about the connection between the earliest Arabs of that area, the Dawasir, and let's see. And the Amalekites, who are also otherwise known as Amorites, and rulers of the Midianites, as well as connected with the group called the Telsim. Okay, here's my post, and I was showing you the area of the Dawasir in Yamama, and which is also called Wadi Dawasir. And I was saying, in the Chalcolithic era, which was preceding the Iron Age and Bronze Age in Arabia, there were Well, they say it's the Copper Age because the people represented in rock art in the area, in certain areas of Central Arabia especially, mentioned by a person named Anadi. First mentioned by people named Anadi were Negroid, you know, elongated Negroid people who were engaged in mock battle. And often shown with copper swords and implements. I don't know how they knew it was copper, but apparently that's what they say, copper swords. So these warriors were imitating, you know, kind of according to Anadi, he thought they were involved in mock battle, just like the Maasai and other groups in East Africa use today. But they had these ostrich, you know, were often wearing ostrich feathers, and the black people in that area today called the Dawasir tend to, when they were first found by the colonialists, were engaged in the trade of ostrich feathers. And they were described often as giants or black giants. And because, like other people, and this group belongs to the Azd people as well as the Taglib Ibn Wael. Now, Taglib Ibn Wael happens to be connected to, Wael is actually a son of Casit, just like Namir is a son of Casit. So the tribes Taglib Ibn Wael, Namir Ibn Casit Ibn and Wael Ibn Casit were all closely related, but have been there for thousands of years. And we know that because, like I said, the name Rabbean is actually connected to that of these tribes who come from the Rabi'a. According to tradition, they're from the Rabi'a, who was a son of Mudur, son of Ma'ad. And this Ma'ad was the son of Adnan, who was the founder of Aden in the Yemen. So all these traditions are relating the people of Central Arabia to early people in the Yemen. But these Ma'ad people in the Yemen, as I said, they moved during the time of Jeremiah and Nebuchadnezzar's invasion of the Yemen, moved into the Hijaz, where they later were called Madinoy by the Byzantines, early Byzantines. So that's why you find people like Jerome, Saint Jerome, a Greek or Byzantine author, referring to them as Madianoi, and the Greek, the Torah, which, you know, has been translated by the Greeks, call them Madianites. So these Madianites came from an area called, you know, that was near the Dhul Madan in Yemen, and that's why you find Madan and Madian brothers and children of Keturah, who had also settled early in the Hijaz. In fact, I think they were the earliest settlers of Hijaz before the Jurhum or Hadurim people came up to Hijaz. There were also Amalekite people there in Hijaz, but this is long before the Ma'ad people came up from Aden during the time of Nebuchadnezzar. According to Al-Tabari and other Arabic sources of the Muslim writers who are writing in Arabic. So the people in that area of Wadi Dawasir or Yamama as it's called, were originally the Amalekites, or people of Amalek, who was the son of Eliphaz, one of the rulers The Amalekites were rulers of the peoples of Esau or Edom, or they came to be. And that's why it also says that they came to be inhabitants of southern Canaan. And we said southern Canaan was in, well, further, first of all, it was south of Mecca, and it was where the Canaan people were located, and up until the 20th century were located, extending down to the area of Amran and other parts of the Yemen. So between Mecca and parts of northern Yemen, you had an area called Canaan. And next to that was the Asir area. So the plain next to the Asir, mountainous area of Asir, is called Tahama. Or the deep, you know, the Tahama flat, lower blue plain. And that's where Canaan or the Wadi Kanana also was, and the plain of Kanana, mentioned by medieval writers, because the Kanana tribe occupied the area. So when the Torah is talking about all these different groups, Midianites, Amalekites, Amorites occupying Canaan, this is the area they're talking about. They're not talking about some area, imaginary area up in the Levant, which never saw, you know, these early Israelite people.
That's some good information here.
Well, it's interesting you say that, because that's the information I've been saying for the last it doesn't stick with people, though.
Right, it's starting to focus in.
Mm-hmm. So the area of Canaan and the Canaanites, the people that we are, you know, associating with the Philistines, Amalekites, all those people, Phoenicians even, the original Phoenicians, there were Phoenicians that went up to, you know, further north, also known as Nabataeans later. At least the Greeks considered the Nabataeans to be the Phoenician people. The Nabataeans were also considered by Arab sources to be the Thamud. And so we had found through documented sources that these Nabataean peoples were the same people that were called Al-Nabayt. So the Al-Nabayt were a tribe of the Aus or Uz. Aus were a group of, do you remember what the Aus were a group of, Marzu? Aus and Khazraj? No?
I don't want to say the wrong answer.
Okay.
I know it's in my notes. Okay. I know it's there.
Okay. They were a group of, basically they were the people that comprised the Ansar of Hijaz. So Khazraj and Aus, biblical Uz and Gezer, okay, were the people who had come up earlier than the Maginoi as Amalekites, because all these giant peoples, the Adites, Amalekites, Nabataeans, Aus, Khazraj, all these giant peoples were related. Okay. The Phoenicians were in part made up by the Nabataeans, but there were also groups like the Salamians that were kind of considered Phoenicians as well. So not all the Phoenicians were, you know, these tall people, huge people. However, a large percentage of the early Israelites, Canaanites, the Aram tribes, the Nabataeans were of these people. And these people had groups among them that were artisans, just like the modern Tuareg, who are considered Amalekite in origin, have their artisan groups, okay, that dealt with, the making of implements and blacksmithing and silversmithing and mining. Okay, the Kenite peoples. And the Kenite peoples, as everybody should remember by now, or that are considered by archaeologists to be the people that venerated a god known as Yahweh. So the Kenites of the Hamathites were the Jews, were the original Jewish people. Okay, and they were found among these taller groups of people, and that's why you have, you know, the different stories in the Bible about David and Goliath, Samson, and that kind of thing, because they're talking about these different groups that occupy the same areas in Canaan and Aram. Now, Aram, as I said, is not considered a place in Syria in these early, in the early medieval writings. There, it's considered to be a people who came from the Yemen, who are related to the Adites, related to Mash, related to the Nabataeans. Nabataeans are the people that brought the Aramaic dialect up to Syria. Now, the Nabataeans also, however, are considered the peoples of Nimrod. Okay, so that's how all these traditions link all these people together, Nimrod with Kush and with Mash and with Aram. So the real Nimrod is considered again to have lived in the first dynasty of Uruk, which is why we have to get the chronology of these areas together. The alternative theorists bring the start of such peoples into the middle of the second millennium BC, not back in the third and fourth millennium, whatever, third millennium, like they some of the scholars do today. So it makes more sense if we're talking about something in the middle of the second millennium, because like I said, you have the names of these groups in Babylon were the same as those in even modern Yemen and Central Arabia. But basically it was considered that the Namir ibn Casit, brethren of Wael ibn Casit, from which came the Taglib, the branch of Dawasir, a branch of the Dawasir, moved into Babylon in some early period. Okay. And again, these were people were also connected to the Amalekites who lived there. That's where the, I didn't get to the important part, the Amalek was an early leader or ruler of the people called Talsim or Tassim, Tassim or El-Talsim, that were in Yamama. These El-Talsim happened to be Latushim of the Torah. Now, Latushim, do you know who Latushim or Latusim is?
Okay.
All right, so Latusim, and like you might have heard of Dedan and Latushim and Shua being, you know, closely connected to the Midianites. So let's see, let me see if I can find it. It says in the Torah, you know, and of course Josephus just talks about just basically translates the Torah using the word Sus. Now the sons of Sus or Shua were Sapta and Dedan. The sons of Dedan were Latushim and Asurim and Luhamim or Luam here. It's the translator writes it, Luam. The sons of Madiah were Ephes and Ophren and Anak and Abida and Elda. Okay, so all these groups, the Afron, of course, are also called, translated in another part of the text as Afer. And he's supposed to be brother of Epha or Apha, Yapha, and Abida. Abida are still located near Sana. Apha are groups that are both in Yemen and in I think one country in the Horn, but I can't remember it. But the group called Yahar in Somalia and the group called Yahar of the Yafi in Hadramaut were once related. So those groups are the ones they're talking about. All these Elda, Abida, Anuk, which is probably just another name of the Danakil, and the Afar. But it also talks in another part of Josephus, Antiquities, about Afrin and Yafrin. So one of the tribal groups of the Tuareg is called, of course, Banu Yafrin or Ifrin or Ifrin. And those are the people that found places in Niger. Was it Mali or Niger? Ifrin is in, I think, maybe Mali. But also the Banu Ifrin were part of the Zenata Berbers who founded places like Sijilmassa and Fez in Morocco. Okay, but so the point is all these people, the Latushim are basically the same people as, and these Dedan people, Dedan, Latushim, Assur, are all related peoples. The Tassim of Arabian tradition and the Odudawa, the giant, Asurim, which is the name of the early Luwata Berbers, otherwise known as Tuareg today. Okay, so these are the people that are definitely being talked about in Josephus and in the Torah. And that is why in the Targums, Targum Jonathan, I think it was, Dedan is called again Mazik or Meshek. Again, connecting with the Mash and Meshek of the Bible, because Mash in one part of the Bible is called Meshek. And again, connecting with Meskiag, Kash, of the early ruler of Uruk. Again, connecting with Masik, the ancestor of the Tuareg and other Berbers, the Masmuda, actually, Berbers of the Shluh, consider themselves Emazig. So that's where that word comes from. But Mazig was the son of Canaan. Okay. In Berber lore, Mazig, again, son of Canaan. This Mazig is none other than Meshek of Arabia. Meshek are mentioned in Nabataean inscriptions as one of the Nabataean tribes. That's why I said these tribes came from the south. They settled in as Nabataeans in Babylon, in later on in the Levant, where they're called Phoenicians. In Arabia, they're also called Thamud, and they founded Dumat al-Jandal in the Jalf area of Saudi Arabia, otherwise called Adumatu, and the people are called Idumeans, or Duma, son of Ishmael. Okay, so if in order to understand anything, related to Genesis, you have to understand that these people were not people of Levant, but people of Southern Arabia and the Yemen who went northward. And some of them never made it into the Levant.
So you're telling me where that's Canaan down, and we understand that. So the Canaan that is connected to Levant, that's not legitimate. Is that the right word to use?
Yeah, I would say that's not the Canaan of the Old Testament. Okay, I'll just put it that way.
Okay.
Now, as I did say, there are Canaana people mm-hmm. who belong to the Hamada, otherwise known as Hamdan in South Arabia, but became known as Hamada in further north in Sinai, and also places like I remember Canaan is south of Mecca, where the Hudhail and other Kanana people, Kazaima people, Alkara people were. But the Kanana tribes in the Gaur or Jordan Valley and in Israel or Jericho, they named that area much later. So when people say that, you know, they found some kind of archaeological ruins that the Egyptians talked about in that area, that's fine, but that has nothing to do with the Kanana that are there now, nor with the Canaanites of the Bible. The only thing I can say is that the Nabataeans may have brought the name of the Kanana with them, or Canaan with them. And that might have been how, you know, an earlier remnant of Canaan was in the area. But because, like I said, the Nabataeans and Canaanites were the same people, or Nabataeans were considered descendants of Canaan. Nimrod and the Nabataeans were Canaanites, period. Even here, this guy, Mohsen Zakari, a scholar, is writing what was thought. They had their homes in Babylonia, and their first king was Nimrod I. That is to say, the Great. They were known as Chaldeans, or Kazdan, Kasid. That's where the Nimrod ibn Casit likely comes from. Known as Janaba or Janban, Yaramika, that's where the word Yarmouk comes from in Syria, and Kuder or Kutaran. So Kuthar and Kedar were connected. The Ishmaelites are in the Bible are actually the father of Kedar and Nebaot, or the Nabataeans. Nabataeans were Canaanites, according to Al-Masudi. So they're also known as Canaanites. These were the Nabataeans who constructed buildings, founded cities, dug canals, planted trees. They were all Sabians who worshiped stars and idols. Now this guy is quoting a Nabataean, I think. It's not him saying that. This guy, Mohsen Zakari. Let me see I forget which Nabataean. I don't know if it was Ibn Nadim again.
Excuse me, I need to take a break.
Okay.
I'll be right back.
All right, should I keep talking? Okay, I guess so. Okay, so what I was saying is this Mohsen Zakari, let's see, he's author of Sassanid Soldiers in Early Muslim Society, The Origins of Ayyaran and Futuan. Okay, so this is a scholar who's writing a book not long ago, 1995. Let's see who said that. No, it's not. Al-Masudi. So Al-Masudi of the 9th century was the one who said Nabit bin Canaan bin Kush bin Ham. Oh, I'm sorry, no. Al-Damashqi says the following concerning the Nabataeans after mentioning Nabit bin Canaan bin Kush bin Ham. So for Al-Damashqi, a Syrian, I think 1300s, just like for Masudi, these people were connected to Canaan and Kush, who are also connected to the early Mash and Aram and Adite people. or Thamud people, from which came Lukman. Okay, so they had their homes in Babylonia. Their first king was Nimrod. So this Nimrod, like I say, is whom archaeologists or archaeological specialists consider to be Enmerid or Enmarkar, the hunter Enmar, who was son of Meskiag. Am I even right sharing it? Nope, I'm not sharing it. I hate when I'm talking for 5 minutes and not even sharing it. Okay, so I was just saying that it's Al-Damashqi who also says that after mentioning that Nabayt was the son of Canaan, son of Cush, son of Ham, says that they had their homes in Babylonia and the first king was Nimrod I. Okay, that is to say the great. Nimrod I and I was saying that the archaeologists consider that Nimrod was the Enmerkar or Nimrod the hunter of early Uruk. And I think the first or Sumerian dynasty of Uruk. So whenever that was when the Nabataeans were in Babylon. And they could not have been talking about the third millennium BC. It just does not make sense. So it's more likely that the alternative theorists are correct in their assessment that those dynasties begin approximately 1600s. And that the Sumerians actually came later. The Sumerians were later than the Akkadians. Yeah, that's what I think some of them think. But anyway, again, the Chaldean, these are not my parentheses. This is the guy, the scholar here who wrote that book about the Sassanids is quoting Al-Damashqi of the 1300s. So 700 years ago, the medieval Arabs are still believing that the Kushites, the people of Kush and Canaan, which of course ended up in Africa, but are also found in Arabia, in the area of Amran and the Tahama, or Yemen, were the originators of civilization. And of course, Nimrod is connected with Odudawa, or Dedan, and Kush, or Nimrod is called, actually he's called Bin Casit, or bin Arfakshad, So these Kazdim, these people were the Kazdim of Josephus. Chaldeans and Kazdim and Cushites and Canaanites were all the same people who knew the stars and planets, who created civilization. Or at least that is what the medieval Arabic writers thought. So, see, a lot of people don't understand. What was interesting, what I had found was that these people called Kuder that still occupy parts of North Central Arabia are still known by names that were listed as children of Ishmael in the Torah. Okay, so when I'm talking about the Torah, in case people don't know, I'm talking about the earliest part of the Bible. Not the Old Testament, but the earliest part of the Old Testament. And here, Al-Masudi also wrote, the Chaldeans are the same as Assyrians that were formerly called Nabataeans under Nimrod. So he is saying that there were a people of the Assyrians that were also called Nabataeans and whose leader was Nimrod. Doesn't mean that all Syrians were Nabataeans. Not all Syrians were Chaldeans. But the Chaldeans were the people that were called Nabataeans. Again, he says that the people of Yarmouk in I think it's Syria, was it Syria or Iraq, were also early people, inhabitants of that area were also Nabataeans and were a community of Hebrews living in Palestine. Okay, so the Yarmouk Nabataeans were also living in Palestine as a community of Hebrews. So I had also found that the people of the Yarmouk Basin in southern Syria, now we still find these people here. They're lightened up probably, but there's still some Black Syrians and nobody knows where they came from, supposedly, even though the medieval Arabs tell us that there are Black people called the Nabataeans who had built all early civilization and who were also called the Yarmouk. So here we go. Wikipedia says Black people of today's Yarmouk Basin in southern Syria. Some local stories report Sudan as ancestral homeland of the Yarmouk Basin's Black people. In any case, they have lived in the area for a long time and are culturally and linguistically assimilated into the local Arab population. Now, who's the real Arab they're talking about? Who's the assimilated ones? The early Nabataeans were literally the early Khatan peoples that had gone northward. Among the earliest of the Khatan people that had gone northward. Also the Shamar people lived there, so that could also be why they're so tall, dark. The Shamar, of course, were originally people of the Tai, Medij. However, a lot of the Shamar in Syria are not dark, so I don't know. Let's see. Okay. So just to show that the Bible is based on real people, the Genesis portion of the Bible is based on real people who are in some cases still known under the ancient names. Again, here Masudi wrote about the Nabataeans in his time, which is the 9th or 10th century, saying their descendants were in a state of dependence and humiliation, now dispersed in Iraq and other provinces. So in his time, these Black people called the Nabataeans were already in a state of humiliation, just like they are today. So much for people with no civilization. Okay, that, I like what I wrote here. Okay, now back again to the physical anthropology. That area of the Gar and the Haran, as well as the Haran, as well as certainly the agricultural populations of Palestine, were found to be kind of we're definitely found to be dolichocranic, which is the mostly Africans have that characteristic of a skull, which they don't really use that as much anymore as genetics, but it said this dolichocranic people of the Himyaran population was unaltered until the Parthian period, as in southern Mesopotamia. That's when people of Parthian or Persian or late Persian ancestry came into these areas of southern Mesopotamia and basically changed, the appearance. They were brachycranic, the Parthian people of Syria and southern Mesopotamia were brachycranic. These are the people also shown in books pertaining to ancient Mesopotamia, similar peoples to the Kurds. Because the Kurds or Guti were possibly the Guti, are the people usually shown in books that were, trying to represent ancient Sumerians and Akkadians and people of that sort. But those people are known to have come in later, much later than the original Dolichocranic inhabitants. Dolichocranic means, or Dolichocranic means longer headed, long and narrow head, rather than, you know, broad headed people.
That's how they determined who the people were?
No.
Go ahead.
No, not necessarily, but what it shows that there was a change in the population around a certain period.
Okay, so they were looking at the skulls that they were founding and saw that there was a change in the skulls.
Yes.
Okay, and the,
Well, it says that they think that the, after the period of the Achaemenids, Persia came to be dominated by these Scythic peoples or foreigners. And then, you know, by the Parthian period is when you find most of these people in Persia and in, and they even moved into Mesopotamia.
Yes.
Okay. So, let's see. And that's why I wrote down here how the early Orientalist scholar Ephraim Spicer said, there is a marked discrepancy between the evidence of the cemeteries uncovered in Sumer and the appearance of the historic Sumerians depicted on the monuments. For it has been repeatedly observed that the monumental representations of the Sumerians point for the most part to pronounced round heads. So the monument, the representations seem to be of the round-headed people, whereas the evidence in the cemeteries uncovered in Sumer show different. There were actually the Dolichocranic people, Dolichocephalic people. But, you know, all of this is due to the supremacist, Euro supremacist views that were in effect during the colonialist period, during the Orientalist period, that there was a, decided want to ignore who the original peoples of Mesopotamia were. And they were definitely, and including the inhabitants of Arabia who were south of that area, showed definite connections with Africans. The earliest peoples of the Arabian Peninsula showed definite anthropological, physical anthropological, and cultural connections with Africans. So, for example, I was saying that in the Ubayid culture, which used to be considered, really old, like maybe 3000 BC or whatever. Or I don't know if it's Ubayid, but whatever culture there was that found, I think it was the Ubayid, they found a very large bodied and Negroid people. They used to say that they were considered Negroid with Oriental aspect. So, however, later on, during this time of Kuhn and pseudo-anthropologists, they started to develop this Mediterranean race stuff and this idea that there was some kind of Eurafrican. So they made them into Eurafricans, even though they had flat, broad platter and noses, or at least the findings of many of the skulls, and distinct prognathism. And so they were not of the, and they were large bodied. So they were not of the, so-called gracile Mediterranean type or Ethiopic type. Now you might find in modern Ethiopia, among many Ethiopians, for example, or even among many Yemenites. They were probably ancestral to the, you know, peoples like the some of the Dawasir and other groups found in Central Arabia. Like I said, I had seen myself with my own eyes a man who was a huge in proportion. I mean, I'm talking about just everything huge about his skeletal, you know, skeletal frame in when I was a young person, when I was about 19 and I was living in New York in a YMCA. And somebody had come from, as part of the El Karj, which is near Riyadh, El Karj, he'd come from a base, military base. And I was talking to him and I was asking him, and at the time, I didn't know that there were any black people, you know, in Arabia except as slaves. And so I had said, asked him if he was a descendant of slaves, and you know, he was really like, he didn't understand what I was talking about. And he said, and all the people of my town look like me. And I asked him what his town was, and he said something like Uda, and then I later found out it was like Uda or Judah. I couldn't remember then afterwards. Later found out that there was a town called Al Uda or Al Ud I knew it wasn't Jidda, but I knew it was, and it sounded like the word Oud in it, had the sound Oud in it. Later found out there was a place near Riyadh called by that name, and many, you know, people of his color, which is my color, or darker than me actually, are found in that area. So, sticking with some of the archaeological evidence, not only do the Garanchians have certain, you know, connections with Meroe in terms of their pyramids and things, but they also have stela, also had stela found under the monuments resembling those of the Phoenicians. And that probably represents the movement of the Canaanite peoples that Ibn Qutayba and Wahb Ibn Munabbih had said came into the Fezzan area, including peoples like the Zagai and the Tuareg. Now the Tuareg were not Garamantians because they destroyed Garamantian civilization. They did not plow land like the Garamantes did. So they were probably an early Barbara population. They're called, the Garamantians are called black, or sometimes black as pitch, and they're called Ethiopians. So no point in trying to confuse them with the Tuareg. No point in trying to say that they were, you know, some kind of mulatto or modern whitish people of North Africa. They were definitely African. So again, sticking with archaeology and who the Nabataeans were, okay? So for example, I wrote that Ibn Sa'd, who wrote Kitab al-Tabakat al-Kabir, considered the Nabataeans the same people as the Thamud. The Thamud, who were a remnant of Ad or Ad Aram. Again, they're relating them to Aram or the Arameans, the wandering Arameans. The Banu Ad were known in their time as Ad Uram. When they suffered disaster, the Thamud were known as Thamud Aram, who are the Nabataeans. All of them professed Islam. They lived in Babel till it came under the sway of Nimrod, Ibn Kush, Ibn Canaan, Ibn Ham, Ibn Noah, who asked them to worship the idols and they complied. All right, so. Okay, so again, he's saying Nimrod was a son of Kush, and Nabataeans were the Thamud, who were Adites, And of course, the Adites and the Canaanites and all those people were basically the same, because Shaddad is sometimes even called a son of Canaan or a son of Cush. Let's see. Anyway, there's a lot more I could talk about, including the connection of the Tuareg argam or a tomb type with those found in East Africa as well as in certain parts of the Yemen. So we definitely know that there was movement from the Yemen into East Africa in a very ancient time period. You can always say that, we know that these argam are not as early as the ones in East Africa, probably not as early as the ones in the Yemen. The Tuareg claimed descent from Thaimala, who was a Nabataean deity or ancestral, because like I say, when you're talking about ancestors, you're often talking about deities and vice versa in the African tradition. And that includes the Afroasiatic tradition. So, and those become the names of tribes. So there was a tribe called Thumala or Thaimala. A Nabataean tribe called Thaimala, and in fact, the later Thaimala were related to the Khazraj, I think, or As people. So again, showing all the connection between all these supposedly huge people of the Khazraj, Aus, Nubayt, or Nabataeans. The Azd, there were the Azd, who were also Amalekites, and who were also Adites, and Thamud, all the same people. It just so happened that these people had lived amongst other peoples who were often, agricultural people, because the Nabataeans originally were not agriculturalists. They despised working with the land like the like a lot of other Bedouin. Theodore Siklis says that they did not, let me see if this is the one. They did not drink wine, and they did not, here we go. So in the time of Theodore Siklis, the Nabataeans were considered as a people who never liked to plow the ground. And remember, in part, they're the Mashaik people, or at least in the inscriptions, they're called Mashaik. And in the Bible, of course, Mashaik, son of Aram, or Mesh. So he says there were 10,000 warriors, saying they were by laws, their laws prohibited from sowing, planting, drinking wine, and building houses. Every violation of the precept being punishable with death. The reason assigned for this very singular rule is their belief that those who possessed such things will be easily brought into subjection by a tyrant, on which account they continue, says the historian, to traverse the desert, feeding their flocks, which consists partly of camels and partly of sheep. Okay, so those are the Nabayt, al-Nabayt of the Aus further south. Remember that. They're nomadic people by this time who are basically not, dwelling in stone houses, whatever. And they were involved highly in the frankincense trade between Gaza and South Arabia. And that was by the Achaemenid time, I guess. I guess I'm not sharing the screen. Let me see if I'm sharing the screen. Yeah, I should be sharing it. All right. Well, say that again.
It was a photo of, I think it's pronounced Daif.
Yeah, this is a Hawatate man, and many of the Hawatate, the Hawatate claim descent from the Nabataeans, as well as they are also of the Sulamian people. The Sulamian people are still living south of the Dead Sea as well, so north in the Jordan Valley. But southward, of course, they were known as the Banu Sulaym. So the Sulamian and the Nabataean people ranged together over these areas like the Hara and the Haran and Hijaz, two black people. The Sulamians were not the giant people of the Nabataean type, but lived with them and had a contractual relationship as shown in the inscriptions. And which I had said before that the Ansar tried to keep with the Sulaym. They asked it was the Al-Aws group, which is a Nabataean group that tried to keep an allegiant contract with the Sulaym people, Banu Sulaym. So all these black people among the Hawatate and other tribes in the Sinai region, I shouldn't say that, because a lot of those other tribes are of Kuda stock, or Kuda Himyarites, or else of the Harb people, who lived also in the Hijaz area. And the Harb come from the Gatafan tribe. So they're Kais Ilan of Mudar too, but they're actually different people and very different in appearance, smaller, than the original, probably a lot smaller than the original Aws Khazraj people, who are often described as giants. Al-Mutalib, Ibn Abd al-Mutalib was, and his sons were described as huge, looking like black camels circling the Kaaba. That's because they're huge because they were of the Khazraj. And Nabtal al-Harif, you guys probably don't know who that is, but different individuals that were of the Aws and Khazraj are often called giants, and I had mentioned that Ubadah bin Samit, whose name is a combination of two different Nabataean gods, was of the Khazraj people, and he's described as a giant over 8 feet tall, and that he's the one that said he will bring back 1,000 men from the Hijaz blacker than he was, and probably of the same height too, so that was probably scary for the Byzantine ruler in Egypt. So these people, I don't know if I can, let's see. Like I said, are the Az people, many of them, these tribes were extremely black in color. They're represented by people like some of the black Dawasir people. And there are many of these Dawasir people playing in the soccer leagues in Saudi Arabia. You can see them. You can see them in certain videos. So we don't have to go over to Arabia, whose people have been there the black people have been there in many cases for thousands of years, and tell them that they're African. When Africa did not exist, the name Africa only existed because some black people of Arabia moved into Africa thousands of years ago, or during the time of, as Joseph has said, of Afur and the Keturah settled at the Troglodyte area of the Horn, and then named Africa. So, I don't know if I'm covering everything that needs to be covered in terms of the traditions of the West Africans, but what I just need to distinguish is that, or point out is that, so we're talking about two separate people. We're talking about these giant groups that used to occupy Arabia, as well as the groups that came to be called Jews or Judeans, that were Metallurgists, Kenites, Hamathites. But interestingly enough, the name, like I said, in the Bible, Hamath is considered to be Ham. In one part of the Bible, Ham is called, or Hamath is called, the child of Ham. The word Hamath is likely related but anyway, so there's a lot of the discrepancies can be only really understood if you understand that these people they were all Black. Genesis is about Black people that lived in southern part of Arabia and then moved northward. They might have originated in different parts of the world before they came to that area, southern Arabia or the Yemen, but they moved northward into the Hijaz and finally Sinai and the Levant, bringing their names with them, including the name Negev, including the name Lashish, Beit Lahim, and other South Arabian names that are still found in South Arabia. So when the Bible, when they're talking about the Negev, they're not necessarily talking about the Sinai of the modern Sinai, Negev, but of the ancient Yemenite region. Haran, the name Haran is also found as a place in Yemen. Syria comes from the name of a people in Yemen. So we also have to be careful of what, you know, which Syrians we're talking about, like the Assyrim and the Syrim mentioned as being related to Medinites, or of course, we're not talking about Assyrians of Mesopotamia, but there was an Assur of the Yemen as well. So possibly when Josephus mentions that these people in Africa had once harassed and conquered Assur, which is translated as Assyria, unfortunately, they're probably talking about an area of the Yemen and not the Assyria up in Babylon. I mean, it's possible because, like I said, the Selene also were, and the Nabataeans did stretch from the Levant and, at a later time, did stretch from Babylonia and Mesopotamia to the Levant and the Hejaz, you know, after moving northward. However, this was after, you know, it's considered after the Azd people and Moses, their leader, or Musaikia with Zarifa, who's the Zephora of the Bible, moved away from the Himyarite area. And they first moved into the Asir region. So that area, you know, wasn't even the original area of Israel, but later on you find a lot of the Israelite names and Sulaim names there. You find, the names of the Edomite peoples there. You find the Dawasir people there. But basically it was even much further south that you find names of the Israelites. So that is how, you know, if you look at the Sugai people, somehow at some point in time, they came into the area of Fezzan, might have either overcome the Gamfasantes or mixed with them, or, but they're the ones that probably or likely founded Garma or Jarma, or at least more all the hydraulics there and the Phoenician, a lot of the Phoenician relics were probably due to them, as well as the Carthaginian Now, if you look at the, interestingly enough, if you look at the Nabataean ruins, or excuse me, the ruins at Uruk and the Carthaginian ruins, it's almost the same level of masonry. Let's see. We have Uruk here. And of course, it's supposed to be built by the peoples of Nimrod and Meshek. Now that's me who's correlating these names. Okay. First, it's the other scholars have said that Enmerod is very likely Nimrod, but it's me that's making the connection between the Meseks and Meshek and this Meskiag Kush or Kesh. And the early Gistubar is supposed to be Gilgamesh. This connection between the Gistubar or the Bur Kashtu and the the hero Gilgamesh and the Kashtubar or Gistubar of the Sumerian epic or later Babylonian tradition. So let me see something. What did I bring this up for? No. So I'm not saying that Meskiag was necessarily Meshek. I'm just showing you that Nimrod in Arab sources is said to be the son of Mesh, who is also called Meshek in the Bible. So there's a good possibility that that's, a tradition comes from the fact that there was a ruler or rulers in Uruk, whatever period it was, named Enmerud and Meskiag Kush, that were of Nabataean or Central Arabian origin. And these Central Arabian blacks are connected to the Dawasir. Let's see, or that's where the traditions of, what I'm saying is that's where the traditions of Nimrod being a giant comes from, these Dawasir giants and these as giants, because the Dawasir are not only of the Banu Taglib, connected to Banu Taglib, but they're also Azd, direct descendants of the Azd people. Okay, I brought up Uruk because I wanted to show the Carthaginian ruins. And the level of the Phoenician or Nabataean ruins. You see, again, the Phoenicians are supposed to be the people that built Carthage, and yet the Nabataeans, according to the Greeks, were the Phoenicians. So all these people are, again, like I say, related. These Nabataean people who are always connected with their, in like a feudal relationship with these other people, these Kenite artisan types like the Sulaim or Balkain Kuda. Okay, and I'm sure the same connection that continues today among the Zagai people or Songhai Soning people and the Tuareg, because a lot of the artisan class or caste of the Tuareg is in fact Soning Songhai. Those are the smiths, blacksmiths, the silversmiths, the artisans of the Tuareg. They're the same people. Okay, Carthaginian ruins, let's see. So I'm just saying, if you put two and two together, that's what you come up with. Let's see, the Carthaginian ruins are
on pictures. One photo said that the Phoenicians.
Where?
The second row right there, yes.
Yeah. Well, I mean.
But all of it is Carthage, though, right?
Yeah, Phoenician. Well, when they see Phoenician and Carthaginian ruins, it's because they're thinking that the Carthaginians were not all Phoenician. However, the early Phoenicians, like I said, were basically the Canaanite peoples, both these smith and warrior peoples, noble warrior peoples, mm-hmm. nomad or Bedouin peoples originally, and then the smiths, metallurgists, masons, or artisan class were, in Africa at least, were the Zugatani, the Zawaga peoples. And that's why you find the early remnants of the Carthaginians, their mummies show Negroid types of people. Because the Zagawa or Zagai, Songhai, Zawaga people were the Moors that, according to the Portuguese and according to tradition, were the Carthaginians or inhabitants of Carthage. Now, I'm sure, like I showed previously, that the masks, a lot of the Carthaginian masks look Tuareg as well. So I'm sure the Tuareg were there too, or at least, you know, some of them. But let's see, but this is not much different than the Dartichit, early Ghana. Because it was built by the same people. There are many, many ruins of the Carthaginian type, what happened to the other? Oh, look at these. Reminds me of certain places in West Africa. Okay, so thought to be a place where the Phoenician princess Elissa landed in Tunisia, worshipped Baal Ammon. So here we go again with the Ammonites, Ammonite, Moabite, Menaean people, just another name for the Solomonian groups. So, I hope Africans start researching their own history instead of allowing, other groups that have either come in later. Yeah, so. All these Cyclopean ruins, they used to call them Cyclopean. All these large ruins and megaliths, I don't care whether they were found in Europe, found in Arabia, where they're found. Originally, the people that brought them there, Central America, were these African people, like Masudi said, these black people, whether we call them Nabataeans, Canaanites, Kushites, I guess that's basically it for today. Say that again.
I'm just going to say that's some really good information there. I enjoyed this today. I enjoy it all the time, but this right here, it gives me really, this source right here, this study. a lot more than what you've given us before. Let's put it that way. I'm starting to understand, you know, because you're drawing from the same, this, you know, you're going to different people, but you're drawing from the same Yemeni, I guess, or a South Arabia source. So,
right.
And this is, that again?
Just trying to explain the why there's probably a lot of validity to some of the African traditions, a lot of the biblical history, even, you know, the Greek mythology has a lot to do with the movement of these folk and the original settlement in Arabia and their spread abroad. As it says in the Bible, when the Canaanites spread abroad. And the Sabians also dispersed or, you know, came divided, whatever.
Yes.
That's the same, basically the same story. And even the story of the Ethiopic wars. Let's talk about I don't know if it's the Greeks that talk about the Ethiopic wars. But and unfortunately that book, especially the book about the Ethiopic wars, was lost. But supposedly it said that these people like the Latutian, Lahumim, and other Kaftura and all other groups left. They were all fighting together, and then they left and, you know, became, you know, extinct or, that kind of thing. But they, you know, they didn't really become extinct. Some of them went to Africa, where they still are. And I showed them, the reason I'm posting these Black Jordanian, so-called, you know, I'm sure everywhere in the Middle East has seen an inflow of Africans, because in the last couple hundred years, before, you know, 20th century, or before the 21st century, I should say, I mean, still Africans are trying to make them slaves, but before that period, or after the 17th century, there were a lot of slaves that were being brought into the Near East and stuff, but they've confused those slaves with the indigenous peoples, you know, the Kedem, the Akdem, the old peoples, Kedem peoples of Arabia and Syria, and even Iran, because there were Iranian blacks probably long before there were the so-called Zand were brought up there. Even though the word Zand in Iran refers to, you know, it referred as much to gypsies, because the original gypsies are dark too. And also the Middle Eastern people used to use it for the Keelan or Kualan, Kualun people further east in Indochina, where there were also blacks, which is why Al-Jahiz talks about China being one of the places where a lot of, you know, the blacks were.
Yeah.
And Indonesia too. It's where the Java, especially, where it's called Sin, where the blacks, you know, Sin were. So you just have to try to sweep out the dross, or the, you know, the inconsistencies and discrepancies by knowing the history. So this Al-Salahiya is, I think, it's in the Gowana people of Israel. Okay, so the Jordan Valley doesn't just take up Jordan, but involves Israel and Palestine, and Jericho was one of the places, but this is Al-Salahiya, probably named for the Banu Saleh or Sheila of the Bible, who, you know, a tribe of the Kuda, Amorites originally, and also said to be called Abu Ma'ad, who settled in the early Christian era, as late as the Christian era, or right before it, in Palestine and Syria. Okay, so these people are not, or Yemenites that came up there much later. And Hijazis, actually, that came up much later into Sinai, and this is, like I said, Israel. So
those, I'm looking at their structures there. Those look like some of the Native American here in the U.S., the way those huts are made.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the mats.
I'm sure it looks like the Asian, too, some of the mats.
Uh-huh. Oh, yeah, without a doubt.
And, but, yeah, these mats are, they're found probably all over Arabia and, yeah, so, but the Kuda are important because, you know, that's where they're related to the Mara, the Bara, Shara, Mara people of Yemen and Oman. And they were also the founders of the Kindite dynasties of Hadramaut and Central Arabia. That's extended between Hadramaut and Central Arabia. But they were also, like I said, the Ma'ad. And the fact that these Ma'ad were called Madianoi and Madiani by Jerome, i.e. Madianites, and came to this region only in the Christian era, or right at the turn of the Christian era, just shows you that there's something amiss in the biblical, you know, interpretation mm-hmm. of where these people came from. So these are the, like I said, the Ma'ad people and children of Adnan. The story of the Greek stories of Danaus are said to be related to the name Adnan. I'm not sure if that's true, but let's see. Okay, and here's the these are other Gawarna. Again, all these people are trying to call them Africans as if they have some recent connection to Africa. Obviously, they're affiliated biologically with Africans, and genetically, that's the case too, especially with North Africa and East Africa. Interestingly enough, not so much as with West Africa. But the fact that they're, you know, still Sudanic in appearance, and these areas were called black, occupied by near black people with woolly hair by earlier medieval raiders. So Jericho, Beit Shan, and other Gawarna towns were occupied by black people in 1,000 years ago. And you know by their names who, you know, where they came from, because they have the names of the ancient peoples of Hijaz, of the Nabataeans, and of the Sulaim. So the Hawitate, some of the black Hawitate are also connected to these people. And the other group that had a large number of the tribal names of the Sulaim are the Harb people that used to live in the Hijaz, and whom, according to certain colonial writers, were at least the purest ones were, you know, chocolate colored, whatever. Let's see. So the Mahamida, and other Masra Harb or Salim Harb from Gatafan, from the Gatafan group, were closely related to the Sulaim. And these people too, Sulaim and the Nabataean people. I don't know if I'm still showing them. Yeah,
it's the ones in that one hood.
Yeah. So, of course, these people have mixed or observed other folk. At one time, they were probably just like other, you know, African people. They're probably not dressed in long, whatever you call these are called. And the Galabias, they probably weren't dressed.
Galabias.
Yeah.
You say they wouldn't have been dressed like this?
I shouldn't say that because, it does say that the Saracen groups, at least, were only dressed in tunics to the waist, and the Nabataeans too, loincloth and tunics to the waist. So, however, you do see, like in some of the ancient Egyptian paintings, you do see some dark-skinned people with these kind of longer robes on. Mm-hmm. So I don't know who exactly they were, but it could have been Phoenicians that, you know, had lived in the area long before the later Hijazi people, the Arab Hijazi people came. Phoenician, I'm talking about the Nabataean and Salimi people of, you know, further back than the medieval time, further back than the Christian era. So I don't know what they were dressed like back then, but I know that in Arabia, don't seem to have been wearing much in the way of clothing, as well as they always wore their hair in braids and cornrows, plaited cornrows, and two, they said two, sometimes two braids that stuck up like, what do you call it, horns.
Horns, uh-huh.
At least in the front, you know, it's weird. So, and they also had cowrie shells, you know, as jewelry, just like Africans, you know, basically the same people. Mm-hmm. So, and they had the grass huts, they had the mud huts, they had tents. A lot of times they had the tent, goat hair tent. Black goat hair tents, or kedar, we call them. Yes. So, and these are more agricultural people. The Guarana are more agricultural people, and they use the buffalo a lot, and not so much. Now there are, supposedly they're settled from being Bedouins, because there are a lot of Bedouin Guarana people as well, but, and I've shown, you know, the Bedouin, let's see, Bedouin, the schoolboys of this Dead Sea in their classroom in the Gore. They're Bedouin. Let me see. I can find some. Oh, I have it on my, I think I have it on my recent, I'm going to, sharing this one. The Numair boys. Oh, it's probably not it. Let me see. I think I had put this on it after, or no, this was the Moorish one, no. The one before African Odyssey. Else's. Anyway. Hey, somebody's. Ooh. Somebody's saying my site's worth 3,000. That's interesting. I'm looking. I see. I have to make up the index for this page because hard to find the other. Should have done that long time ago. The other pages on the site. Did I put it up here? I have no idea where it is. The index.
That's what you're looking for, is the index.
Yeah, because I'm looking for, oh, is this it? This should be it. Here we go. Oh, did I find it? Do you see these boys here?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So these are Bedouin children of the Gur. And they're of a place called Wadi Numir, I think. See? So the Jordan Valley or Gur, that the area they're in is the Golan Heights. I mean, it includes the Golan Heights, which used to be called Jund Philistine. And it includes the descendants of the Jadam Arabs, which are Azd, the Bali, which are Kuda, the Zubaid of the Madij, and many other groups. Okay. So these are Bedouins of Numera.
It says they became to be called Ishmaelites and Israelites.
Those are the same people that came to be called Ishmaelites and Israelites, yeah. In fact, the Jadam Arabs, especially, they were said to have occupied the land of Israel. The land, it's called, they were called the something of the Israelites. I forget. I can't remember, but that's another, I have that on another blog spot, I think. Let me see, Israelites, do I have it here? Because the Jadam and the Yashkar or Ishakar were closely related to the Sulaim and the Lachim, Beit Lachim, who are all Azd people. Beit Lachim, they're also called. And here we have, again, Manasseh, or Mansur actually refers to Manasseh, who was with Ephraim, their sons of Joseph, who are Israelites. So, you know, people can pretend if they want that there were some other people besides these black Arabian people that were the Israelites and Ishmaelites, okay? So here's, I showed Estonians who were I guess they were supposed to be rescuing the black Saracens from the sea. And here, if you look really closely, you'll see that the Saracens in the sea, here they are here, and here, and then here, being thrown out, Estonians yes. in Estonia. It's a church in Estonia of the medieval era. And here's a white Saint George. The white angels. And the
now is that a crap?
Harrison.
Okay, and what's that above? Mm-hmm.
Go ahead. I'm sorry.
I was asking, what's that above them? That gray thing with the the rays coming down.
Looks like a cloud or something. Because apparently, it's supposed to be about and I have to find the you know, the original source. Mm-hmm. That's one thing that I regret. I should have kept that, but or retained the name, but I think it was supposed to be, when I read it, was about these Saracens had been thrown into the sea, and then they were rescued by all these Estonians angels.
Mm-hmm.
And they returned, I think they were supposed to be converted to Christianity or something of that sort, converted to Christianity, to the Christian faith, due to their, you know, being saved. Anyway, let's see, fascinated by my, for some reason, I'm the only one that finds these pictures and puts it all together, but, you know, like nobody, I had not seen almost any of these pictures before I put them up here. And then, you know, I try to explain exactly what they are. This is the early Umayyads, you know, not who were related to the Hashemites and all the early Quraysh. And then it shows some of the, a tribe with or the Turkish ruler. You know, her darker skinned people with a Turkish ruler. And the Azazma, who are related to the other Bedouin of Jordan. Some of the Azazma, who they try to make into the non-Arabs, into the slaves, black slaves. And here are, I just showed these because these are Sudanese Arabs. And that supposedly from the Bakara, most of the Bakara are composed of the Sulaim, tribes that, you know, originated in Hijaz and the Hara of Hijaz. And that's why this guy, his Harold Michael had said that Bakar Arabs, for the most part, who they don't just occupy Sudan, they spread across to Nigeria now. They're in Chad, they're in Nigeria, Niger and Nigeria, but also Sudan, and they came down from Egypt. So most of these people were once of the Sulaim tribe, who were Judeans. You even have a Salamat, the name Salamat is still found among them. Okay, well, I mean, I can go through all my, okay, I don't even know if I read this part. The Nimrods were the kings of the Syrians, whom the Arabs called Nabataeans. Oh, I did read that, or at least another version. The Nabataeans founded the city of Babylon. The inhabitants of Nineveh were those we call Nabayt, or Syrians. And of course, up here we have Ibrahim ibn Wasif Shah in Muqtasar al-Ajaib saying, among the children of Canaan are the Nabayt. Nabayt signifies black. Nabayt, son of Mash, having fixed his residence at Babel, these are the Nabataeans that gave kings to Babel. His descendants seized all Iraq, who covered the land with cities, introduced civilization, and reigned with unequaled glory. Time has taken away their greatness and empire, and their descendants, in a state of dependence and humiliation, are now dispersed in Iraq and other provinces. 10th century, only a thousand years ago. So we're talking about, you know, yes, it was a long, long time ago, but it did happen. Looks like it did happen. And the Azazma are supposed to be related to the Maaza, Anaza, and the Maaza. Are two closely related tribes in, you know, spread between Syria, Iraq, and Sudan. And actually, there are Anaza tribe in Sudan as well. So Aiz is a root meaning goat. And the Maaza are also mentioned in Assyrian inscriptions fighting against them, I think. So, but the Naza that are in Saudi Arabia today are descendants of people that came down, back down into Arabia from Syria. They're Syrianized in appearance. So they're not, you know, they don't look like the Naza that came into, or that are in Sudan, just like the Habaniya. They're actually dark skinned and look like Ethiopians in both Yemen. They looked Ethiopian like in Yemen and in Sudan, except that in Yemen now they're trying to put pictures of other types of Jews in with the Habaniya and claiming that they're all Habaniya, which is not true. And the Haban, according to Arab manuscripts, were descendants of Bahila, while the Habaniya in Yemen claimed to be descendants of Dan. So Bahila happens to be the Arabic name for Bilha. Bahila are mentioned in, or a tribe named Bahil are mentioned in Southern Arabia and Yemen in ancient inscriptions. So pre-Christian, pre-Islamic inscriptions, before Christ. Yeah, so here is another Azazma, probably, you know, very much like the ancient Nabataeans or some Lamy looked. Because remember, that's why I keep emphasizing what the Selenians look like, or what they said the Selenians look like. Tacitus spoke of the Selenians. Joseph spoke of the Selenians. They both said that they were likely the founders of Jerusalem, and that, or that, you know, most people, Tacitus said that there were, people thought they either came from Assyria or from Ethiopia or from, or were the Jews. And the reason is because, of course, at that time, most of the Judeans were of Ethiopian appearance, meaning black. And of course, the people that colonized Assyria, or the, not, I shouldn't say Assyria, but Assyrim, the original Yemenite areas were black. People that colonized Syria in general were black, and that's where the word Syria comes from. Let's see. All right, yeah, so I'm basically finished with the Nabataean, and the, you know, I wanted to mainly emphasize where the connection was with the Tuareg and the Songhai groups, actually, especially the Songhai groups and their connection with the Gai, and their founding of these various towns throughout the Sahel and Sudan. Kanem, or the Kanuri of Kanem, are their descendants, and born of Bornu are their descendants. Now many of these groups, these people also had slaves, you know, the Kanuri and the Bornu kingdom, Kanem, all those people had slaves. And they had dynasties that were Zagai, and had dynasties that were, or Berber, and they had dynasties that were Tuareg, or at least the Zagawa, the Kanem did, I think. But further south, the Songhai towns were also called Berber, and the area from Ouargla to Ghana was occupied by the Berbers, meaning the Songhai, not today's Tuareg, and definitely not modern type Berbers that come from everywhere, really, but speak Berber, or have the African Asiatic dialect called Berber. All right, well, yeah, I'm just looking through the fascinating photos I've gathered on the site. Shabam in Hadramaut was mentioned in the Bible. Sebum. And Hadramaut is where you find places like Sion, which was where the name Zion comes from, so-called Sion. This is Shabam. Of course, these people, the appearance of these people are changing as well due to the, you know, much influx before of Persians and other groups, Turks and other groups. So I also, here is, remember I said Nabataeans also sometimes are called Amorites, and here a text says their hands are dressed, or, you know, they were the nomads in the deserts. Their hands are destructive, and their features are those of monkeys. They never stop roaming about. Their ideas are confused. He's clothed in sack leather, lives in a tent, exposed to wind and rain, and cannot properly recite prayers. He eats raw flesh. That was a characteristic of the Amorite and often of the early Ethiopians as well. Well, actually, not even early, but apparently very late.
Yes.
In Ethiopia, he has no house during his life, and when he dies, he will not be carried to a burial place. So.
Now this is what this Daniel Bodie wrote.
No, this is he's quoting. Sorry, he's quoting.
He's quoting. Okay.
Early Mesopotamian. Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. Let's see. Where is that from? Oh, yeah, so it's from a few books by scholars. Mm-hmm. And I'm just assuming it's by scholars because of the subject matter. Let me see. This one is, it depends on who it's published by, too. Oxford University Press, yeah. What caught me with this one is features of those of monkeys. So you know who that's about.
Yeah.
although the Chinese used to call the those people like the Tatarians and other, you know, the white people, they used to call them what do you call it? There's a kind of monkey that they used to call macaque. But of course, they're not talking about that because these are the people that are, let's see, this is or it could even be another time kind of Semitic people who were, you know, black, but just thought that the certain groups of certain types of nomads looked more monkey than they did. I don't know. That's but anyway, Hammurabi was one of the Amorite people.
Okay.
Yeah. And I know that at a certain point, other people came into Mesopotamia that were not black, as obvious from the appearance of the Assyrians. So. But the earliest Amorites and the Akkadians and Sumerians were probably the same people. But there were Kurdish people or Guti people who were related, possibly related to the Kurds. Some people think that, I'm not sure. So yeah, this is coming from, but if you look at what the early Sumerian specialist Kramer says too, he also says that they were the people of Sumer, you know, were definitely dark brown color. And related to certain peoples in the Gulf countries that were a remnant of the early, the so-called, well, he said so-called Gracile Mediterranean type, which is another word for like Ethiopic types that are in Arabia and the Gulf and Egypt, or were there at least. Anyway, all right, any more questions?
Nope, that's good enough for me. I've got plenty to look at.
Okay, let me just share. Yeah, just was enjoying, you know, taking a perusal of the sites. And,
I guess so. I'm looking forward to this, to your classes. This is, I mean, this, wow, yeah, you can't get anywhere else.
Yes, you cannot. But you have to start, maybe you should form a study class or something with your folks too.
I'm working my way towards that because I'm starting to understand. I don't want to jump out there and say something wrong. So, I'm making sure that I got everything right before I start teaching. But some of this is coming out, though, believe me.
Okay, great. Yeah, mm-hmm. Good idea to not get anything wrong.
Yeah.
That's how, you know, bad information spreads.
Yes. Yeah. Yes. So, we don't need any more of that.
Right.
I'm trying to get it right. Mm-hmm. But so now, are you going to try next week, or well, I'll just keep my eyes peeled?
Well, again, I'm going to try every week from now on until back to school, and then or back to teaching school, and then we'll see what happens. Because
I look forward to next week.
Yeah, I have to maybe switch my Arabic class because I'm supposed to usually do around 2 or 3. I was supposed to do be tutored, and I moved it to tomorrow. Mm-hmm. But so I might change that to tomorrow and start trying to do class early.
I'll do my best to start recruiting more people to come in. They're looking at your videos though, because I shared a lot.
I'm
sorry.
No, but what I'm saying is like the fact that so you do like what you said you're going to do, and you can get together with a small group of people and start sharing, bringing those books that you have, all your new books,
mm-hmm.
With all the corpus of Arabic sources, in African history, West African history,
mm-hmm.
that type of book with you, and go over certain paragraphs. Why do they say this? Why do they say that?
Yes, like what you just taught us today. Now, you've shown us this since you've been doing this class, but for some reason, it's sinking in a little bit more now that I'm hearing. I guess after you hear it a few times, it starts sinking in.
Which one? You're talking about the Canaan?
Yes, about Canaan, and then just everything that you spoke about today, really, for me.
Yeah,
It's starting to sink in where I can, make comments to people or, say something to certain people and, to add to the conversation. But, this is really just proving who we are.
Mm-hmm.
And I just relate back to, I had some people, even during my service days, tell, you people don't even know who you are. And, at the time, I couldn't do nothing but get mad because he was right.
Wait, you said that? Oh, in the service?
Yeah, I was in the military and we were overseas, and it was a Mexican that said it to me.
Oh, wow.
And,
I'm glad you said it.
It made me go out and try to, find out who we are.
And that's the thing is that, people say culturalist Africa. I read that a few years ago about a newspaper article that was quoting Chinese, because they were harassing the Africans over there. And they were saying something about culturalist Africans. And go back to Africa, culturalist.
Yeah.
And that just, it kind of made me think, well, it's a shame that, colonialists have gone around the world and told people, that Africa was basically, anything created in Africa was created by whites or some kind of not African people. So that's mm-hmm. what happens, and so it's up to Africans and people of the African diaspora, including the people that live where Africans are written, were before in Arabia and in India and other places, to mm-hmm. To learn the truth so that they're not because if you look at it, all the black people in Jordan and India, the darkest people, are the ones that are, their culture and history has been usurped.
Yes.
And other people have put themselves in place of, the Kushites that were in India, making all these great civilizations. And the Nabataeans were the ones that were over in Iran, and according to the Arabic text, it says that they were the first to be called Aryans, which is funny.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
But it's not just not to say that black people are any different than any other people. They're not lower, they're not higher, but you do want to understand where does the civilization, how was it inspired? Why was inspired? What inspired movement? What made it tick? And it wasn't this materialistic civilization that we have now. And it wasn't slavery either. It wasn't slavery that allowed those little ancient civilizations to grow and create the great religions that we had or that they had back then. So, but like I say, the reason I'm doing it is because of that, especially the spiritual aspect and that people need to understand how they thought, you know, their beliefs about reincarnation, no death, that all was an illusion, you know, that those are not things that came up with the so-called Greek philosophers or even the Hindu philosophers of later, you know, later Vedic philosophers who just got their information from the Kushitic people that were there originally anyway. But, you know, that's what humanity comes from, a higher state, you know, a higher state of being, a higher state of mind.
Yes.
Those were that was the impetus for ancient civilization, you know? I'll get more into that. Again, I'm going to start, I don't know when I'm going to start my healing class, but, you know, that's the purpose of the healing class to pick this up. This is going to show why the healing works, or why these shamanic beliefs and practices worked and how they were used, you know, during these ancient times. Okay. And why we people suffer and how to address it. And why it was addressed by shaman, you know, or by in certain ways through the earth practices, through the plants, you know, and the fauna, and respect for that. So.
Yes. Okay.
All right. Well,
I appreciate your time and thank you very much. And I'll look for your word from what you're going to do next week.
Yeah. I'll plan that soon.
Okay. Peace and love.
Thank you, Marcy. Thank
you're
you.
Welcome.
I love you too. Okay.